Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Spring 2017 Speech Night. My name is Ryan Guy, and I'm the Director of Forensics here at Modesto Junior College. And over the next hour and a half, you're going to have a chance to witness some fantastic performances put on by California and NJC's award-winning speech and debate team. So in a second, I'm going to have those folks come up here so you have a chance to meet them before the show. But a couple quick housekeeping things before we get going. One, if you've got like bags and stuff that are in the aisleways, you need to try to keep those clear so you can kind of put those under your feet. We would appreciate that for, you know, like fire concerns and that kind of a thing. The other thing is if you have one of these devices, our performers would be really, really appreciative if you went ahead and silenced those so that they weren't going off. And also, it may not seem like it with all these lights, but it can be pretty distracting if folks are distracted by these devices during their show. So if you can pocket those, the performers would really, really appreciate it. A couple other things. My guess is a few folks are here as a part of a requirement for a public speaking or other comm studies class. If that's the case, a lot of instructors still ask you to pick up one of these critique forms or made it available digitally online. If you do want a digital copy of this, you can visit mjcforensics.org and download a Word document, but I'm guessing a lot of folks picked these up. As the presentation goes on, you're going to be filling this out for a lot of you. And what we're looking for you to do for most classes is on the first side to go ahead and write down the name of the performers as they come up, and then to give a little bit of information about what type of speech was, what topic it was, and then over on the side, we ask you to do a rank in comedy. So we have a little bit of a scale on the top. How would you go ahead and rate these speakers and compare it to others? One being superior, four being unprepared, and fill that out. And then just to go ahead and write a little bit of comments on how you would rate and evaluate the program. So this provides some good feedback and tends to give some good information to your instructors that you are actually here. The end of the evening is made up of a parliamentary style debate, which can be pretty fun. The performers here will tell you a little bit about that in a while, but that's also where you're going to want to fill out the back of the form. Again, putting the speakers' names on the back and summarizing a little bit about what their arguments are. Most instructors ask that you do both sides, so that's that. For many of the classes, what they're looking for you to do is to take this form, staple your ticket to it, and bring it to them at the next class period. All right, let's get to the fun stuff. So, Modesto Junior College is one of the oldest speech and debate programs in the country. We actually have records going back to the 1920s when we used to debate surrounding colleges and even big universities like Berkeley, and we have close to 100 years now of success in doing that. The individuals that you're going to see tonight spend a lot of their time working and trying to fine-tune their craft so that they can go to other universities and compete and really show that NJC is pretty awesome. So, I look forward to giving you off the opportunity to check these folks out. As this evening cruises on, I want you to keep one thing in mind. A lot of these folks that are on the team now were sitting in the same place that you are tonight just a year or a semester ago. So at the end of this evening, if this seems like something you're like, hey, I think I could do that, come see me or one of the members of the team. We can give you some information about that. And again, that website has some information as well. At this time, I'm going to go ahead and turn the floor over to my co-director of forensics, Professor Tori Shemp, to introduce you the MJC speech and debate team. Have a great show, everybody.
Today, I have the pleasure and the privilege of introducing the Spring 2017 Speech and Debate Team to all of you. So please help me welcome each member as I introduce them. First up, Lena Alahri. Angela Bass. John Browser. Austin Castro. Alexis Dye, Eric Fuentes, Kaylee Inman, Jordan Johnson, Matthew Mackey, Jared Medeiros, Nicholas Navarro, Cody Peterson, Brad Alfred Phelps, Jake Schoenberg, Brendan Ward, Emily York, and Abel Zambrano. Your Spring 2017 speech and debate team. You will see many of these fine individuals performing tonight. At this stage, I'm turning the show over to the Masters of Ceremony, Lena and Austin.
Good evening, everyone, and we would like to once again welcome you to the Spring 2017 Speech Night. We are going to be your Masters of Ceremony for this evening. I'm Austin Castro.
And I'm Lena Alahari. And we will be your guides for today's event, introducing you to our lovely team members and the event they will be performing to tonight. Since this is both our first semesters on the team, I think you'll be the better judge of how lovely they really are.
So let's dive right into it and start off with one of our limited preparation events, the impromptu speech. Our speaker will have 7 minutes to prepare and deliver a well-organized and insightful speech. This includes 2 minutes of preparation and a 5-minute speech. I will give our speaker a sheet of paper with 3 quotations on it, and he will choose one, interpret it, and decide whether he agrees or disagrees with it.
And first speech, we have Eric A. Fuentes. Eric is currently studying cinema and TV arts as well as communication. He has been on the team for 4 semesters, and a little fun fact about Eric is he woke up in beast mode.
So let's take the L and bounce right back into it. During Eric's prep period, I know it's in the script. During Eric's prep period, we would like to ask the audience to remain especially quiet because it requires a lot of concentration. I will also be giving him time signals to let him know how much time he has remaining for prep. So without any further ado, please give it up for Eric. Time starting. Seconds used. One minute used. Minute 30 used.
Is a hot dog a sandwich? Okay. So these questions can be mind-boggling and very confusing. Today I received the quotation, "Happiness can be found even in the darkest of times, if one only remembers to turn the light on," by Albus Dumbledore in Harry Potter. And I interpret this quotation to mean that you may have to do a little bit of research before you can find out if a hot dog is truly a sandwich. You're gonna have to put in some work behind that. Today, I'm gonna explain why I agree with this quote through 3 main points of analysis. First, I'm going to talk about the professors here at MJC. More specifically, I'm gonna talk about my coaches, Ryan Guy and Tori Shipp. Second, I'm going to talk about the song Work by Rihanna. And finally, we're going to conclude by talking about the Twilight series and Bella and her love for Edward. So let's dive into this topic and talk about the professors here at MJC, and specifically Tori Shimp and Brian Guy. Now, Tori Shimp and Brian Guy are the most charismatic, fun individuals to be around. They are some of the greatest coaches that you will ever meet. They are so caring and they're so there for you. Like, if you have any problems, So I actually took them as my own personal counselors because I always have a problem going on in my life. And I tell myself, okay, you know who I should talk to? Brian Guy and Tori Shimp. And you know why they're such a great influence to be around? It's because they're so educated and they have the experience in going as a college student. So whenever I look to Brian Guy and Tori Shimp, I think, okay, they put in hard work, they do their research, they know what they're talking about, and I can definitely learn from them and their own experiences. So now that we've talked about Brian Guy and Tori Shimp, let's talk about the song Work by Rihanna. Some people actually don't really understand this song because she can sound a little bit repetitive with saying work, 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 work. Okay, so the moral behind this story is that she wants to show everybody that if you want to be in a relationship with me, you're going to have to put in work. You're actually going to have to tell everybody about me. You're going to have to tell everybody that you're with me and that we're together. Relationships can be a lot of work. I mean, a lot of work. I mean, so much work to where you're completely forgetting about yourself. So when we look to Rihanna as the prime example of showing work, she has completely decimated and dominated the music industry with so many hits. Starting in early 2006, Rihanna has completely changed the way the music industry and landscape for other people to come alongside the road. So when we look to Rihanna, we don't just look at the song Work, Work, Work. We're looking at an individual who has put in work, who has shown that she is a hard worker, and she continues to showcase this with her success. So now that we talked a little bit about Rihanna, let's talk about Bella and her love for Edward and Jacob. Okay, so the story behind this is Bella is somebody who is transferred from Arizona over to Washington. And she falls in love with this vampire within not even 2 weeks of school. And she just has an undying love for him. She loves Edward. She wants to be around him every day because they have so many moments with each other. They have moments of sitting in random fields of grass together and just loving each other very dearly. And to Bella, this means the world. I mean, we've all had those moments of falling for somebody completely nonchalant and not understanding why. No matter what Edward did, she left. And then when it came to Jacob, she was like, oh, I like you as a best friend, but you know, I really love Edward, but stay alone just in case. And when we see both of the hard work put in by Jacob and Edward, you can look to them as prime examples of people who will continue to work for their love. They love Bella, and they're going to continue to showcase their interest in their relationship. Much like what we've seen with Rihanna and how she said, if you want to love me, then you're going to have to work for it. There's hard work shown throughout all these relationships. So today, let's recap on everything that we've talked about. We talked about the professors here at MJC. Well, more specifically, Brian Guy and Tori Shimp, how they're supportive. But the support comes from a long line of research and hard work and dedication to this school. And we also talked about the song Work by Rihanna and how she continues to put out so much songs for us to dance to in the club or continue to dance to and get our groove on. And we also talked about the Twilight series and how Bella and Edward and Jacob continue to show their hard work and love. So next time when you look back at the quotation, happiness can be found even in the darkest times, even if one remembers to turn the light by Albus Dumbledore from Harry Potter, remember that you're gonna have to work for what you want. You're gonna have to go out there, put the effort in, put your research and time. into whatever you're doing, because the outcome is going to be the best. And when we think of the phrase, is a hot dog truly a sandwich? We can look at this and think, okay, I'm gonna have to do some research. And once I find the answer, then I'm gonna tell everybody if it's truly a sandwich.
Thanks, Eric, and really great job with that speech. Our next speech will be the informative speech. This speech is designed to describe, explain, explain significant developments in technology, science, or society.
Our speaker will be Kaylee Inman. She is currently studying communication. This is her second semester on the team, and a little interesting fact about her, she loves Disneyland and cats. So let us welcome Kaylee to the stage.
You try to catch your breath. The walls are closing in on you. The inevitability of doom is enveloping you into the darkness. In a moment's notice, fear can rattle your entire world. But what if I told you there was a way to eradicate this feeling entirely? According to the Anxiety and Depression Association of America, anxiety disorders are the most common mental illness in the United States, affecting 40 million adults aged 18 or older, or 18% of the population. The organization goes on to state that post-traumatic stress disorder affects 7.7 million adults, or 3.5% of the population. With anxiety and panic disorders affecting a mass of the population, creating a drug that will help erase these fears and traumatic episodes from the memory can be a much healthier and happier society. Today, I'm going to inform you about the drug that is helping to cure fear, propranolol. First, we'll take a look at its intrinsic nature and how it is affecting those with anxiety disorders. Next, we'll study its current applications, and finally, we will dive into its individual and societal repercussions. Let's take a step towards conquering our fears and take a look at how this drug works. According to a January 2016 New York Times article written by Richard A. Friedman, Dr. Meryl Kint, a professor at the University of Amsterdam, has seemingly erased the emotional fear response in those suffering from arachnophobia through the use of the drug propranolol. Propranolol, as stated by the Mayo Clinic, is a beta blocker. It works by affecting the response to nerve impulses in certain parts of the body. In the past, exposure therapy was the only way to help those suffering from anxiety disorders. However, according to Psychiatry Advisor, exposure therapy utilizes extinction learning, and while it is often effective, many patients experience a fear relapse over time. In a 2016 New York Times article written by Shane Leibowitz states that propranolol causes a patient's behavior to change first and their thoughts to change after. This is important because the patient's brain is embracing the fear before they can physically accept that it is no longer present. Propranolol for the use of anxiety disorders is groundbreaking because fear can be not only a detriment to oneself, but society as a whole. Now that we have a better understanding of how the drug looks, let's see how it affects those in the current applications. As previously stated, Dr. Meryl Kint conducted a study to cure fear. According to a journal article, last accessed October 3rd, 2016, written by Kint herself, states that spider-fearful participants received 40 milligrams of the beta blocker propranolol. This was double-blind and placebo-controlled after a short 2-minute exposure to a tarantula. To test whether memory reactivation was necessary to observe a fear-reducing effect, one additional group of spider-fearful participants received 40 milligrams propranolol without memory reactivation. The study concluded that in order to observe a fear-reducing effect, memory researchers had to reconsolidate this fear. Now, Dr. Meryl Kint's applications of fear have been applied to much more daunting cases. As previously stated in the News Republic article, Ben Crair tells the haunting tale of Karen Claver's near-death experience. Claver and her husband were staying in Johannesburg, South Africa, on their way to their beautiful vacation home in Port Elizabeth. However, in the middle of the night, Claver felt a presence by her bed, and in a moment, her entire life changed. An intruder demanded all of her cash and valuables, and while she and her husband remained unharmed physically, the emotional damage had been done. Luckily for Karen Claver, she researched ways to cope with post-traumatic stress disorder and came across Dr. Kint's study. Through the use of propranolol, Dr. Kint was able to erase the emotional fear response in Karen Claver in regards to the robbery. Claver states it still feels a bit like magic. The use of propranolol for anxiety is attacking fear in an unprecedented way. However, with great power comes great responsibility. Now that we have seen the tremendous nature of fear and how great propranolol can be to the human psyche, let's take a look at the current implications. According to the organization PTSD United, last accessed October 3rd, 2016, 70% of adults have experienced at least one traumatic episode in their lifetime. And of these adults, up to 20% go on to develop post-traumatic stress disorder. With anxiety and panic disorders on the rise, propranolol might just be their saving grace. However, some scientists are a bit skeptical as to whether or not this method of treatment is entirely ethical or effective. In a 2016 Science Alert article, Fiona McDonald states that memory researchers have not explicitly tried to delete a memory in humans due to its ethical implications. However, studies suggest that it is entirely possible. Not only would it be possible to delete a memory, but Dr. Julia Shaw states the implantation of false memories had been speculated by memory researchers. Shaw states this is the first study to provide evidence suggesting that full episodic false memories of the minute of crime can be generated in a controlled setting. With suggestive memory retrieval techniques, participants were induced to generate both criminal and non-criminal emotional false memories. And we compared these false memories with that of memories of true emotional events. While there is a great controversy surrounding the topics of memory reconsolidation or the eradication of fear, and of course, it may sound like a narrative you would find in a George Orwell novel or some indie Jim Carrey film, the applications on the lives of Karen Claver prove that this drug can be truly beneficial to those suffering from anxiety disorders. So today, I have informed you about the drug that is attacking fear. First, we looked at its intrinsic nature and how it was affecting those suffering from anxiety disorders. Second, we looked at its current applications. And finally, we divulged into its individual and societal repercussions. You take a deep breath and you realize that fear and anxiety can no longer control your life.
Thanks, Kaylee. Great job. Our third speech is going to be a persuasive speech, which is designed to change an audience's beliefs or to move them to some sort of action.
For our persuasive speech, we have Bradford Phelps. Bradford is majoring in biology and chemistry. He's been on the team for 3 semesters, and a fun fact about him is he's graduating from MJC before he even graduates from high school. We'll welcome Bradford to the stage.
In July of 2016, a white social justice organizer named Max Geller was arrested alongside several other white activists during a Black Lives Matter event protesting the killing of Alton Sterling. Geller was photographed being forced to the ground by police. This photo later went viral, spreading across Facebook pages and Instagram posts. Throughout the comment feeds and retweets, a discourse of Max the hero was featured prominently. What lacked, however, was any discussion of Alton Sterling or the Black Lives Matter movement. Collier Meyerson notes in a 2016 article titled, "Here's How to Support BLM Without Making It About You," that Geller's fame in heroism demonstrates the problems posed by white allies in the Black Lives Matter movement. On the best of days, we can be tone deaf to the needs of the movement, and on our worst, we merely set it back. Meyerson goes on to state that there's no explicit place or structure for white people in BLM. It has made their participation complicated and bred a type of well-meaning but oftentimes problematic white ally. As the BLM movement crystallizes its message and advocacy, it's imperative that we find a mechanism to engage without co-opting the message or the movement. So today, we will first discuss the problems posed by white allies in the Black Lives Matter movement. Then we'll discuss some of the causes for these issues before finally unpacking some solutions. So first, let's discuss the problematic role of white allies in the Black Lives Matter movement. Hashtag BLM was created in response to 2 key events. First, the shooting of Trayvon Martin in 2012, and second, the acquittal of George Zimmerman, the man who shot him. There have been many cases since then that have demonstrated the continued need for this movement. In September of 2016 alone, 4 unarmed black men and women were shot by police, according to a regularly updated archive by The Guardian. The intent of Black Lives Matter also seeks to address poverty in black communities, the violence and fetishization of queer and trans black bodies, and the burden shouldered by black women. However, my goal today is not to convince you that Black Lives Matter. They do, and honestly, that should be a given. My goal today is to unpack the role of white supporters in the Black Lives Matter movement. What does it mean to be an ally? How can we promote the movement without promoting ourselves? Is it even appropriate for us to be involved? The answer to these questions are not simple. 3 key concepts emerge when looking into the literature: the post-racism perspective, the centralization of white supporters, and the passivity of allies. First, a significant percentage of white Americans hold the belief that we have moved beyond racism. A 2016 Pew Research Center survey result showed that 38% of white Americans believe our country has made the necessary changes in order to give blacks equal rights with whites. However, only 8% of black Americans believe the same. There is a rift in America's race relations and in America's perception of race relations. The results of the survey show that while white Americans may believe in racial equality, they also think it's already been accomplished. Second, white Americans often centralize themselves instead of those who are impacted most. This is a problem because white supporters often gain additional benefits that others do not. Emma Lindsay notes in a 2016 article titled, "Why I'm Skeptical of White Liberals in the Black Lives Matter Movement," that white activists involved in race activist work are often unconscious of their deeper motivations, but then points to the praise that Mark Zuckerberg received after declaring his support for #BLM. In the previously cited article by Meyerson, we saw how Max Geller, a white man, became this hero online, while that same rhetoric was missing when black members are photographed. Third, the ally identity is a passive one that does not demonstrate the same level of risk-taking. Dante Berry notes in a 2015 Huffington Post article by Sally Cohn that black folks are never safe, so it's important for white co-conspirators or comrades to think about the level of comfort, safety, that's assumed of them by sitting on the sidelines. I want a comrade who's there for me when I'm most vulnerable. So now that we've looked at what the problems are with white supporters in the Black Lives Matter movement, let's discuss where these problems come from. 2 key mindsets undergird the way white supporters approach their involvement in the Black Lives Matter movement. First, even amongst supportive white activists, there's a perception that fixing racial injustice equates to assimilating otherized populations into the dominant white culture. Equality is not just about seeing more black CEOs, but this is what many white activists believe racial equality looks like. Sincere Kurabu wrote for Everyday Feminism that this structure programs the way we think on a fundamental level. It is part and partial to our subconscious being and shapes the way that we perceive the Black Lives Matter movement and its representatives. Second, white Americans seem willing to accept Black Lives Matter only under very specific conditions. Instead of accepting the agents of the movement at face value, they try and control how conversations of social injustice are taking place. Oftentimes, white activists call for Black Lives Matter to adopt gentler tones or model that off of Martin Luther King Jr.'s own appeals during his 1960s civil rights movement. The active unrest, unruly protests, and lack of passivity has caused a great amount of both complaints and detachment of supporters. Renee Sampath notes in a 2016 article for the Washington Post that when America is more outraged by black protesters stopping traffic than by the deaths of unarmed black men and women, we've got a bigger problem on our hands. So now that we've looked at where the problems are coming from, let's discuss some solutions. There's no doubt that the problems posed today are complicated. Fuller Meyerson notes in the 2016 article that while many people believe institutional change only happens when white people get out, seeing white people involved in the BLM movement can actually lead to greater awareness. However, there are 3 concrete steps that we can take today. Listen, educate, and take action. First, white Americans must do a better job of listening to and accepting the experience of black Americans. In the previously cited Pew Research Center survey results, we saw there's a significant gap in the way both white and black Americans perceive race relations. It's time we document and listen to the other perspectives. And second, white Americans must do a better job of educating themselves on the message and the movement. White Americans can listen to Brenda J. Allen, who notes in a 2016 article some materials that advocates can use. She recommends the following books: The New Jim Crow, Between the World and Me, and White Like Me. She then recommends the article titled Curriculum for White Americans to Educate Themselves on Race and Racism from Ferguson to Charleston. And then finally, she advocates that white supporters engage in the article titled Six Ways White People Can Help End the War on Black People. And then finally, we can take action. This can happen in large ways that moves towards real policy changes, or we can take everyday small steps. Identify and look into the policies proposed by the Black Lives Matter movement. These are listed under Campaign Zero, a list of policies submitted to the police force to coordinate changes within communities. Some of these include body cameras, better training, and community oversight. Or you can retweet or repost Black activist posts instead of tweeting or posting your own posts. Some accounts that can be followed are at BLMLA and at BLMNYC. Or you can organize yourself. You can join a chapter in your area or simply donate to one. So today, we first looked at the problems posed by white allies within the Black Lives Matter movement. We then looked at where these problems were coming from before finally looking at some steps that we can take. The success and legitimacy of the Black Lives Matter movement is important for all of us to understand. It's important that we find a way to engage in this important moment in history without making ourselves the center of it.
Thanks, Bradford. So our next event for this evening is going to be Reader's Theater, and it's exciting because this is the first time that we've ever had Reader's Theater at a speech night. Now, before we do that, we would like to ask our debaters to join us up on stage.
So I'm going to give you guys a little overview on what parliamentary debate is. Parley is an event that puts two teams against each other. It follows the British House of Parliament style of debate. Both teams will have 20 minutes to prep for the debate. It might sound like a lot of time, but if you never know what your resolution might be, and you might not even know anything about it. So first off, let's start with the coin toss. And don't have your toes. Feels nervous. If I do it, I do it softly. So it says, do you guys want affirmative or negative?
We'll take the affirmative.
Affirmative?
Affirmative. All right, and here is your resolution. Resolved, the United States federal government should enact a program that requires teachers and professors to carry firearms into classrooms. This should be interesting. Good luck, you guys, and we will see you see the debate right after Reader's Theater. Now, for all of you guys who don't know what Reader's Theater is, it is an interpretation of literature by a group of oral readers who act as a medium of expression for an audience. The emphasis is on the oral interpretation of the printed work and its resultant effect on the mind, emotions, and imagination of the viewers. In this case, we will have a group of three: Angela Bass, Taylor Colburn, and Bailey Coleman. Angela Bass is a dance and communication major, and this is her first semester on the team. And a really fun fact about her is she can actually move her chin. It's actually really interesting. You have to show me how to do that after the show. Now, next we have Taylor Colburn, who is also a communication major. Now, this is her first semester on the team as well, and an interesting fact about her is she has had pizza in 6 different countries.
Last but not least, we have Bailey Coleman. She is also a communication studies major, with this being her first semester on the team. And a really interesting fact about her, she can play the guitar and the piano, but I think my favorite fact about her is she's legally a little person. So let's welcome them to the stage.
Dancing with a bleach blonde tramp, and she's probably getting frisky. And the guys, it takes a tough man to slap her around. Such a bad guy keeps such a good girl down. Right now, he's probably buying her some fruity little drinks because she can't shoot whiskey. Such a big man, but such a little chick. I think it all goes back to his tiny baby pickup truck. Right now, he's probably up behind her with a pool stick showing her how to shoot a combo.
Welcome. Welcome one and all to our murky gray ladder.
Let me take you on a tour through the head-spinning, back-pedaling, morally ambiguous alleyways. Don't be afraid. Come with us.
I dug my key into the side of his pretty little souped-up four-wheel drive. Tell all your friends how you put her in her place.
No. These alleyways will take us through our darkest desires for retaliation and retribution.
Cut my name into his leather seats. 7 pounds of makeup just to hide that beat up face. It's such a beautiful face.
You might not like everything you see.
Had to go Louis Vuitton with a ball headlight. Slashed a hole in all four times. And I've got 99 biker friends that want to kick your ass.
But it's important that you see it.
Maybe next time he'll think before he cheats. Right now, I wish Bruce Lee was here with his trusty nunchucks. Chuck Norris is still alive, so let's call Walker, Texas Ranger.
In our modern society, it has become far more acceptable to confess to having a kinky taste for porn.
Bondage, S&M.
Threesome! Hypothetically speaking. Oh, speaking! Hypothetically speaking.
Oh, yeah.
But certainly, we cannot confess the justified revenge we may be feeling.
Let's get the A-team.
50 Cent with his bling bling.
And a couple of prison guards.
We want to kick your ass. Society says that vengeance occupies the most dangerous and rickety rung on the ladder of cultural taboos.
Ooh, ooh. I got a tattoo. You want to see Angela?
I said taboo, not tattoo. Cultural taboos.
Like societal justice.
She is always interrupting me. You are always interrupting me. I pray your birthday comes and nobody calls.
Well, I pray flower pop falls from a window ceiling, knocks you out. I pray you're both flying high when your engine fails.
We're gonna get you for that.
What is revenge? Or vengeance for that matter?
Is it justice? Some say that revenge and vengeance are the lowest steps taken by the uncivilized and immoral.
Did she just call us uncivilized? I think so.
And immoral, you're immoral as well.
Revenge and justice, an interpreter's theater by the uncivilized and the immoral.
Exactly, the rungs on the ladder.
Wait. Revenge. Vengeance. Just go with it.
Did she just interrupt me?
Through the words of
Bowling for Soup,
Geron and the Long Road to Love,
William Blake and Carrie Underwood,
Valerie Curtin and Barry Levinson,
CBSNews.com and Judd Winnick and Mario Puzo, The Dixie Chicks, Euripides,
William Shakespeare and Daniel Emmett,
Corey Samasco, Ashley Banfield and Larry Solana,
Flat Hat Online and Daniel Peskowitz, George W. Bush,
Barack Obama,
David Kushner,
and Thane Rosenbaum. The definition of revenge, vengeance, and justice is to see that
the guilty are punished. But unfortunately, as time has shown us, it is not that easy.
Oh, that heaven's leaven bolt cleave this head in twain. Oh, what use have I now for life? I shall find my release in death and leave faithful existence behind me.
She's extremely unhappy. Maybe kill herself. Ooh, this is bad.
Oh. Oh, God, on earth and heaven.
Oh, shit. What? That's the translation.
The foolish one. Why should you long for that appalling rest? The final end of death comes fast. No need to pray for that.
Hey, Medea, get over it.
Suppose your man gives honor to another woman's bed. It happens often. Don't be hurt.
So he slept with someone else. Forget about it.
But of me, this thing has happened so unexpectedly. My heart is broken. I am finished. I let go of all of my life's joys.
She doesn't have to
say. My friend's identity was a die. It was everything to me to think well of one man. And he, my own husband, has turned us wholly vile. This much is my service. If I can find the means to devise any scheme to get back at my husband for what he has done to me, and him, and his father-in-law, and the girl who married him just to keep faith.
She wants to.
What she has wronged in the matter of love, nor the soul could hold on to so many thoughts of blood.
She thinks that.
Will that stop it?
She's a little testy.
I shall send one of my servants to find Jason. I'll say that I agree with him, approve of the royal wedding. I'll say it was profitable, excellent idea. I'll send children gifts to the bride, a finely woven dress dipped in poison.
Ooh, this is the good part. We need popcorn.
The king came suddenly to the house and fell upon the corpse. But when he tried to pull away, his aged flesh ripped from his bones. But first, let me rewind. The princess came suddenly to the house and dressed herself in the gorgeous robe. And then she rose suddenly from the chair and walked about the room as the top of her head oozed blood and fire mixed together. Back to the aged flesh part. Ripped from his bones!
Wow, cool! So now what are you going to do to Jason? You've got to do something to Jason.
Oh, we can think of what deed I must do next.
If I should kill my own children, for those children Jason had for me, he will never see alive again.
What? Whoa, Medea, your revenge goes too far. We would never see a mother do something like that to our own children. It's 2017. We are much more civilized.
July 7th, 2012, Bronx, New York. Lizette Manga killed her children by feeding them juice by the de-icer. Colorless, odorless, and sweet, and deadly. Why? Because she thought her husband had cheated on her.
During the Greek time, Medea was banished to the land of Erectus for her actions. But don't even think Lizette the Manga is getting to go to her Uncle Vinny's house to mourn killing her kids. If she doesn't get the death penalty, the Bronx will take care of her.
As humankind progressed, we created a surefire way to establish one's moral superiority instead of relying on barbaric revenge or vengeance.
Is your name Shylock?
Shylock is my name.
You, Antonio, stand within his danger, do you not?
Eh, so he says.
Do you confess the bond?
I do.
Then must the Jew be merciful?
O wise young judge, on what compulsion must I? I am a Jew. Hath not a Jew hands, organs, passions? Fed with the same food, hurt with the same weapons, subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means as a Christian? If we are like you in the rest, we will resemble you in that. If a Jew wrong a Christian, what is his humility? Revenge. If a Christian wrong a Jew, what should his sufferance be by Christian example?
By revenge. Lawfully by this, the Jew may claim a pound of flesh to be by him cut off nearest the merchant's heart. The court awards it, and the law doth give it.
Oh, noble judge, oh, excellent judge.
Tarry a little, there is something else. This bond doth give thee here no jot of blood. One drop of Christian blood and thy lands and goods are by the laws of Venice and the state of Venice.
Thankfully for Antonio, justice can be swift and just. Creations of a court system took a higher step on that grammar, you Adam. Because who would be in for taking a pound of flesh?
June 23rd, 1993. The cut felt around the world.
He's always having orgasms, and he's never waiting for me to have one. He's selfish.
Ecuadorian-born Lorena Bobbitt complained. However, of course, that wasn't her entire story. John Wayne Bobbitt was a world-class jerk who sexually abused Lorena, flaunted his infidelities, and forced her to have an abortion.
Dispatch car 54. We found a man's penis on the side of the road.
Well, that's a different kind of eye to gain her justice, but sounds fair.
Totally fair.
Okay, so are we saying that the courts provide the moral superiority we need by providing justice for all?
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I am the defense counsel for defendant Judge Henry T. Fleming. Now, that man over there, he's the prosecuting attorney, and he cannot be happier today because he's going after a judge. And if he gets him,
he's going to be a star.
But, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the prosecution is not going to get that man today.
No?
Because I'm going to get him. That's right. My client, the Honorable Henry T. Fleming, is guilty. That man is slime, and if he is allowed to go free, something really wrong is going on here.
Counselor, you're out of order.
No,
man raped and beat that woman there, and he'd like to do it again. He told me so. So let's make a deal. You want to make a deal? I've got an insane drug who likes to beat the shit out of women, and what? What do you want to give him?
3 weeks probation?
So you see, it's just not that simple. Throughout time, we've made no progress cleaning up the hierarchy in between.
Revenge
and justice.
January 2013, computer hacker Derek Lostetter exposed the cover-up in the Steubenville, Ohio rape case.
He posted an anonymous video on the city's high school football team's webpage.
The video was of the school's football players bragging about their exploits while raping a young female student.
The maximum sentence for the rapist was 2 years.
Lostetter's sentence, after being caught as the hacker who posted the video, was 10 years.
We've been trained to believe that justice is a sign of refinement, while revenge is a barbaric holdover from a primitive past.
So, where is the student's anonymous avenue to revenge? Rape my professor. All this flatter.
I don't understand how we got the outstanding faculty award. You might be good at teaching other biology classes, but certainly not this one.
You may do well in this class, but only in spite of her teaching style.
His monotonous tone is a recipe for an 80-minute nap.
All right. We've got to get back to the tour.
He's prone to interrupting and talking really slowly.
You are lucky there's no Rate My Classmates website. A surefire way to establish one's moral superiority is to renounce any interest in revenge and to embrace justice.
Life isn't without risk.
You hear that a lot, mostly around businesses or dating or eating fried food from vendors.
But we take risks all the time, every day, in a thousand ways.
Driving a car, talking to strangers, jaywalking.
Those are the little risks that you don't even think about. It's the big risk that makes life interesting. At least it is for Selena, or I should say, Catwoman.
This is the Evgen clan, Russian mob, and they have worked very hard to establish a foothold in Gotham. And they like to relax. When I say relax, I mean book a suite, steal a painting, order a whole sorority of prostitutes, and get blind drunk. Now, I could pose as one of those working girls, but then I'd have to deal with being groped by these dirtbags. Not that I mind groping or even dirtbags, but it's the combo I can do without. Anyways, these guys tend to get chatty when they drink. Now, they make sure the escorts don't speak Russian, and I just happen to speak Russian, so I'll be tending bar and listening, because I'll hear a lot of stuff about the next heist, cars, soccer, and personal size.
But that painting is an easy job.
No.
That sounded like Renault. After killing my friend, he's been locked up. I've got to know what he's up to. Hi.
What the hell? What are you doing here?
Babe, I know you. You are bartender, right?
I am. But I have many other skills.
Well, you should know I am not easily impressed.
Good. I love a challenge.
Go!
Oh my god.
Oh. So this is him? Selena, this is who killed your friend Connie?
Yep.
And this guy whose eye you just... Oh, okay, that cat you just killed out last night?
Yep.
And you're not walking away from this?
No.
So this is about revenge.
Oh, come on. I'll be killing two birds with one stone, because, you know, cats are so good at killing birds. Anyways, I stole the painting that Renald wants, and I have offered him the painting in exchange for a large amount of money. Then I informed the owner I had the painting. He called me many names, threatened my womanhood on a few different levels.
Always charming.
Then we agreed to an amount. And the exchange for both of them is to be in a very public place. Timing is everything. Knowing when to do something is as important as what to do.
There is that damn painting. It must be here. That's it.
Hey, dirtbag. You don't want to touch my painting.
This hour's both and pays for.
Just let me drink it!
I'd like to think that I'm the last thing Renald sees out of the eye that I left him there.
but he's a bit too busy trying not to die.
There we go. In the end, it was an eye for an eye.
The Urban Dictionary states, justice is what you find only in the dictionary.
Marianne and Wanda were the best of friends all through their high school days. Both members of the 4-H club, both active in the FFA. After graduation, Marianne went out looking for a brand new world. Wanda looked all around this town,
and all she found was Earl.
Well, it wasn't 2 weeks after she got married that Wanda started getting abused. She put on dark glasses, long sleeve blouses, and makeup to cover her bruise. Well, she finally got the nerve to file for divorce. She let the law take it from there.
But Earl walked right through that restraining order and put her in intensive care.
Right away, Marianne flew in from Atlanta on a red-eye midnight flight. She held Wanda's hand and they worked out a plan. And it didn't take them long to decide that Earl had to die. Na 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 na. Goodbye, Earl.
Black Eyed Peas?
Na 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 na.
You tasted all right to me, Earl. You feeling weak? Why don't you lay down and sleep, Earl?
Na 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 na. Ain't a dog wrapped up in that top, Earl. Goodbye, Earl. Let's go out to the lake, Earl.
Go back to lunch
and set you in the trunk, girl. Well, is that all right?
Good.
So, is this like an example of here we are, the land of peace, look the other way, look the other way, look the other way.
Angela, you are hopeless. Please, just remember the words of Al Capone. A smile can get you pretty far, but a smile with a gun can get you farther.
Don Corleone, I will pay you anything to correct the injustice we received from that filthy judge.
I am saddened by your daughter's misfortune, Montserrat. My wife is her grandmother, after all. I've never forgotten that honor.
Bonacera stood, crossed towards Corleone, hesitated, whispered something, and straightened to his full height. They stood in silence for a long moment.
You are being carried away. That I cannot do.
They beat her like an animal. She was the light of my life. An affectionate daughter, a beautiful girl. She trusted people, and she'll never be able to trust them again. She'll never be beautiful again. Don Corleone, I will pay you anything you ask.
Now you come to me and say, Don Corleone, give me justice. I will pay you anything. No, I'm not offended. But what have I done to make you treat me so disrespectfully?
I ask you for justice.
You go to the court, and you wait for months. You spend money on lawyers who know full well you are to be made a fool of. You accept judgment from a judge who sells himself like the worst whore on the streets. If you had come to me in friendship, you would come to me for justice. The scum you and your daughter would be weeping bitter tears this day. What is your justice?
An eye for an eye.
You ask for more, your daughter is alive.
Please, be my friend. I accept. Let them suffer as she suffers.
Give this to Clemenza. I want reliable people, people who won't be carried away. We're not murderers after all, no matter what Bonacera dreams up in his foolish head.
Photos showed two young men lying in the street, beaten to within an inch of losing their lives. Maybe we would be better off with a mob mentality.
Shouldn't societal justice ensure that the guilty go punished? Is there a difference? Punishment for a victim's individual desire for retribution? Punishment at the hands of the government?
Good evening. On September 11th, our way of life, our very freedom, came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts.
The victims were in planes. They were in their offices.
businessmen, women, military, and federal workers, moms and dads, friends and neighbors. The search is underway for those who are behind these evil acts. I have directed the full resources of our intelligence and law enforcement communities to find those responsible and to bring them to justice.
Whether we bring our enemies to justice or justice to our enemies, justice will be done.
Our nation has been put on notice. We are not immune from attack.
We will take defensive measures against terrorism to protect Americans. The only way to defeat terrorism as a threat to our way of life is to stop it,
eliminate it, and destroy it where it grows.
Fellow citizens, we will meet violence with patient justice, assured of the rightness of our cause and confident of the victories to come.
May 2nd, 2011. Justice has been done, announced President Barack Obama while a crowd cheered outside of the White House. The architect and face of global terrorism was killed in a firefight with elite American forces.
Tonight, by killing Osama bin Laden, America has sent an unmistakable message. No matter how long it takes, justice will be done.
No. Not really. Michael Woodmansey was a 16-year-old junior at South Kingston High School when he confessed to stabbing, killing, and eating 5-year-old Jason Foreman. His sentence was 40 years, and on September 11, 2011, Woodmansey was released on good behavior after serving only 28 years. A.T. Wall, director, Rhode Island Corrections Department, replies,
"We are all human beings, and some of what we have to deal with is very upsetting to us. And of course we have personal feelings. You don't have to lie. You don't have to agree with it, but we have to follow the law. And the law states that Michael Woodmansey is being released from prison."
My initial feelings were I wanted to kill him, the same way he killed my son. I wanted to hurt him bad. I wanted him to suffer. And those feelings are still in my head every day. And that's the problem. I can't get them out of my mind.
Today, across our nation, people still celebrate and savor the death of Osama bin Laden. Well, now, 33 years later, after Woodmansey was released, Jason's father still wakes up screaming.
We couch our vengefulness in the language of the law, and cast our lot with the rule of the law, with all of its emotional detachment and cool dispassion. Leave revenge to the thugs and hotheads. Civilized people suppress their instincts and moral outrage and recite the script that justice is the enlightened man's revenge.
Simple, isn't it? Revenge and justice,
as any reasonable person will tell you, is the process used to right a wrong.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed this tour for the head-spinning, back-pedaling, morally ambiguous alleyways.
Alleyways we can clean up by eliminating or reconsidering our definitions of this misunderstood subject.
We can liberate revenge and its cultural tattoo.
It's taboo,
not tattoo.
Cool. I'm gonna get you.
Ooh, you wanna see my tattoo?
I pay your brakes squat while you're racing downhill.
We can liberate revenge for that vengeance is indeed ours, a perfectly human and acceptable response to any moral injury.
Yeah, well, my tattoo reads, justice served here.
And along the way, reinvigorate the debate on the shape of justice in our modern world.
Do you least expect it? It would have already happened.
Yeah, well, catch me outside, how about that?
Come on, you guys. I've got 99 biker friends who wanna kick your ass.
Thanks, Taylor, Bailey, and Angela for an amazing performance. So now that we are all done with our individual and interp events, let's welcome back our debaters. We have Matt, Cody, Abel, and Brendan. So here on this side, we have Matt Mackey and Cody Peterson.
And on this side, we have Abel and Brendan Ward.
Matt Mackey over here is a communication major, with this being his third semester on the team. And an interesting fact about him is he is a meme enthusiast. And Cody Peterson is a communication major and has been on the team for 4 semesters. An interesting fact about him is his favorite artist is Kesha.
Abel on the side is majoring in computer engineering, and this is his second semester on the debate team. And Brenton is a physics major, and an interesting fact about him also is he's straight out of Stockton. Brenton is a physics major, with this being his second semester on the team as well. And an interesting fact about him is he wrote a book and is working on publishing it, titled The Ripple Book of Atrocious Puns. So this is a very audience-centric event. This basically means that we want a lot of audience interaction and involvement, and we highly encourage you to knock or hoot and holler if you are in agreement.
Yeah, you guys, don't be afraid to get involved, because I'm sure you guys have some very strong feelings about the topic they're about to debate.
So we'll get started. I'd like to recognize the Prime Minister for a consecutive speech to not exceed 4 minutes.
All right, guys, so thank you for coming out tonight. I'd like to also thank the negative team here. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. So first of all is resolutional analysis. The resolution that we received today is the United States federal government should enact a program that requires teachers and professors to carry firearms in the classroom. Now, this is going to be a policy debate because should is a call to action. Now, the affirmative, because we have the burden of proof, we have the right to parametricize, and we're going to be defining all the terms in this round. Now, we will be today defining all these terms contextually. You're going to be looking at this debate through the lens of net benefits. So, if we, the affirmative, can prove that the world is a better place after we pass this plan, you're going to be voting for the affirmative. Now, if we can't meet this burden, you're going to be voting for the negative. So, the plan. The United States federal government institutes a program that requires teachers and professors to carry a pistol in the classroom. Now, our funding and enforcement is going to be normal means. Solvency. The government already requires any government official carrying a gun to be trained in its use. Now, teachers that work at public schools, for example, community colleges, state universities, primary schools, secondary education schools, they're government officials. So they're going to be trained in the use of these firearms. Now on to the uniqueness. Since December 14th, 2012, there have been 186 school shootings. This has skyrocketed since the past. Previously, the maximum people that had died in a school shooting had been 3. Meanwhile, at Sandy Hook, 20 children and 6 adults died. So we're gonna be passing the plan. Teachers now have guns to defend themselves and their students. This is going to lead to the internal link, that people are going to be saved. There's going to be less harm happening whenever these events present themselves. Now, we're going to be solving for the impact today of deaths. At the point at which children are dying, we know that we can do something to check back for all of these deaths. When we can check back for these 20 deaths of these children that happened at Sandy Hook, and we haven't done so yet, you're going to be passing this plan to solve for this impact of death. Thank you.
Woo! I'd like to recognize the Leader of the Opposition for a consecutive speech to not exceed 5 minutes.
Hello, how's everyone doing tonight? Cool. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to address two new arguments that I'm going to bring up that are bad things about their plan, and then we're going to go on and talk about the specific arguments that they make and respond to those directly. So let's start with this disadvantage of safety. So A is the uniqueness, which is what's currently going on now, which is that when a gun is present and available in a room, it is 15% more likely to be used. And this is from an article on BBC News where they talked about the readily available guns make it more likely for them to actually be used. So let's get onto this link story where we're talking about what happens when the plan passes. When the plan passes, it makes guns available, not just in like public and in society, but in a classroom setting, a place of learning, a gun will now be available. And furthermore, let's talk about this internal link story where we get further along what happens after plan, where there's now an increased chance of shootings actually happening. Now, the affirmative would have you believe that what their plan is doing is creating this safety environment. However, we can see that with the readily available guns, even if the teacher isn't the one perpetrating the shooting, a student could still get their hands on these firearms and perpetrate these shootings. Which leads us to our impact, which is going to be more school shootings post the plan. This is actually a reason for you to just be preferring the negative. Preferring the negative on this. And the negative is going to solve for this idea of more shootings happening, and the affirmative to have you believe the opposite. However, we can see that the plan is going to increase this gun violence. Let's get on to the second disadvantage, which is going to be about the economy. And the uniqueness as what's going on in the status quo is that school programs are currently being cut in the interest of funding deficits. Next is the link, and what their plan is going to do is that plan is going to require teachers to carry guns, which leads us to our internal link. What's going to continue to happen is that this will cause more programs to be cut, because guess what? If you're going to require every teacher and faculty member basically to carry guns, then you are going to have to pay for that in some way. And guns are pretty expensive too, so that means you're going to have to find a way to fund that system, which means more school programs are going to be cut. And let's get to the impacts. The impacts of this are we lose an interest in programs like the arts and extracurricular activities, and guess what? These activities specifically send you to a better level of education. That means you are less likely to not only be in poverty, but also less likely to commit a school shooting. So guess what? This is another instance of where we can either they're increasing school shootings, or they're actually pushing more people into poverty. So now they're making people poor, and there's more shootings going on. So let's get on to that case. So you bring up this great point on their solvency about how basically like these teachers and faculty members that will be now carrying these firearms are going to be government officials, they're going to be trained with firearms. However, they can't just wave a wand and say that that program is going to be implemented. And even if it does, guess what? That's more spending that they have to be trained by that. But furthermore, their argument about this is that I don't think many teachers, you know, I don't think many teachers are personally trained in firearm use. Just showing up for the job interview, hey, we got to train you in firearms before we put you out in the school. And you know, these are the kind of trainings that teachers aren't going to receive post-plan. They can't just say that that's going to happen. Let's talk about their advantage, how there's been an increase in school shootings. And yes, we agree, there has been this increase in school shootings. However, this is not the solution that we need. Look at the disadvantage from before, where it talks about how these things are going to increase school shootings, and how actually having the gun readily available means it's going to be able to be picked up and shot by anyone in a classroom setting. Means it's, you know, in the confined space, much more likely to be used. And now they may come up here after this, and they're going to try to make this argument about how these guns are going to have safety measures, and they're going to be locked away in a safe or something. Guess what? If that gun's locked away in a safe, it is no use to you in a protected environment. So they don't solve for anything whatsoever if the gun is locked away, or they're actually going to cause more school shootings and push more people into poverty. Thank you.
I'd like to recognize a member of government to the stage for a constructive speech to not exceed 5 minutes.
All right, so first I'm going to be addressing their argument about economics, then safety, then I'm going to be responding to their argument on the solvency, and finally, the advantage my partner articulated on basically reducing school shootings. And starting the timer. All right, so on the economics advantage, first thing you said is that schools are in funding deficits. And the plan, we have to fund these guns, etc. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sure our government likes to raise taxes. That's going to be a large part of what happens to fund this program. They're going to raise taxes, and while sure there are going to be some funding cuts, they're going to cut things like our overspending on the military and other programs that can afford those cuts, especially if they're attempting to make a program better, then they're not going to cut other aspects of it and thus make it worse. So there's going to be no cuts in education as a result of this plan. On to the arguments on safety. The first thing they want you to believe is that if a gun is present in the room, it is more likely to be used in that room than it would be if not. I don't really understand the logic they're using here, because what they're saying, if a gun isn't in the room, it's still going to be used in that room. There's still a percentage chance, and bringing that in the room raises that chance. So, non-unique. Basically, the uniqueness point doesn't work. On the link, plan passes, guns are available in the class setting. Yes, that's the entire point of plan. On the internal link, the first internal link point is a rearticulation of the uniqueness point, which doesn't make sense. On the second internal link point, with the gun being available, students can get the gun and shoot. They'd have to take it from the teacher to get it. I don't know about you, but I don't think any instructor is going to want their student to get a gun. And if they're trying to take it, it means they probably want to use it. Which means they have a very good reason not to give that gun to the teacher. Also, plan specifically says they are required to carry it in the classroom, which means it is going to be on the teacher's person at all times when they are in the room. There's a 0% chance here of the student getting the gun while the teacher is carrying it. So, no impact on this argument. Back to the economic argument. On the economics, we get money from reduced security costs and less spending on SWAT teams. Because we don't have to spend as much money on them because there's... Yes, what is your question?
So, what school spending goes to SWAT teams?
None. However, because money from SWAT teams and other security agencies doesn't have to be spent there because they are less needed, that money can then be funneled into this program. On to the solvency for the plan. They said that we can't just wave the wand and implement the plan, that we have to fund it, I just articulated how that money will come because we won't have to spend as much money on other forms of securing these schools. On to the advantage. They said how plan is not a way of solving for this because of the increase in school shootings that will occur post-plan. However, I've articulated how it will in fact reduce the number of shootings because it'll provide a deterrent because there is guaranteed to be a person trained in the use of a firearm with a firearm in that classroom, and there will be no way for the students to get it because the teachers will be like, why do you want my gun? And so, yeah. So basically, yeah. On the safety message argument, how if it's locked away, it's of no use to you. Blow that across because it doesn't do anything to Case. Basically, that means that, okay, sure, we can see that point. They said how we either have no solvency or there are more shootings taking place. This relies on the possibility of increasing the number of shootings that take place post-plan, which will not happen. And we also won't be pushing people into poverty because we're not cutting funding from schools, etc. We're diverting funding from programs that are not needed as much. Thank you.
I'd like to recognize the member of opposition for a constructive speech, not exceed 5 minutes.
So I'm going to start with this econ argument that my partner made along with the safety argument after that, and then I'll go on case and talk about that in order. So what I'm going to do is I'm basically starting, I'm going to talk to you guys about why they're wrong. Are you ready? So first is the econ argument. The first thing they say is the government likes to raise taxes, and that's how it's going to be funding, and they're just going to cut the military. Well, here's the problem. Is our current president wants to actually increase funding for the military, so they're not going to cut funding if they already want to increase it. The second thing is our current president also wants to cut funding for school. Guess what? This is an area where they can cut it to give them power over something else. This is an area where they can cut that funding. So yeah, they're probably going to take that measure and they're going to cut that school funding. He admitted that things will be cut, that somewhere programs will be cut, and that's what's important to this argument.
What was your question? Are you sure that Donald Trump wants to increase the military?
Yes. So at the point where he conceded that programs will be cut, and we can see with the way our government is going, these programs will be from school programs. That we know that this is what's going to happen. That these programs are going to be cut to pay for this funding. And the arts and extracurricular activities, debate, the whole reason why you guys are here watching this, all of your classes that you guys love, theater, these programs are things that will be cut, things that are already being cut right now on the status quo. The second argument I've heard made on this is that this is also going to increase school shootings because these programs aren't here. Because students go to school particularly for these programs. Students join these community colleges, go to these four-year colleges because they want to join these theater programs. That's key to getting them out of poverty, which my partner was mentioning earlier. Them not being in poverty is key to them, well, not shooting up these schools that we're trying to stop them from shooting. Basically, keeping these programs, keeping students succeeding in school is what's important to keeping people from not committing these acts of violence. Onto the safety argument. So the first thing he said basically throughout this entire disadvantage is that he doesn't understand our uniqueness. If a gun is present, it's more likely to be used. It's a rather simple argument. We had a study specifically stating that 15%, that if there is a gun present, it is more likely to be used than if a gun is not present. If there is a gun present, you are more likely to have a shooting. If there's a gun present, students can easily overpower a professor to get that gun from them. This is what makes it more likely to get a gun. He says that they would have to take it from a teacher, and that's the problem with that, is that multiple students can gang up and can take it from the teacher. They can easily overpower the teacher if it's multiple students per one teacher. How many teachers do you have in one classroom versus how many students do you have? On to the on-case arguments with the solvency. So the first thing he said is that he basically already articulated through all of the other arguments on the disadvantages. Well, the problem is this funding is still going to be cut. We articulated this earlier as well. They are going to be cutting it from these arts and extracurricular activities that are so necessary to keeping students successful. And this is what's going to be cut. And this is what's important to keeping students out of violence, as I mentioned earlier. And this is one of the main reasons why they cannot solve for this. Onto the advantage. The first thing he says is that it will be a vital deterrent. But at the point where we have a specific study saying it doesn't work, that when there's a gun, it is more likely that there will be a school shooting, it's obvious this is not a deterrent. It's obvious that this is actually going to increase the amount of school shootings that are happening. Next thing he basically says is that he keeps articulating how it won't happen because, well, one, the teacher has it. He admitted that the teacher will have the gun on hand and that it will be used that way. At that point, we know it's rather easy for students to gang up and take it from the teacher. I mentioned this earlier. The rest of the arguments on this advantage are basically saying how it won't happen. But if you look at what I've been saying earlier, that it is easy. We have a study showing we have the ability of the students to gang up and take the gun from the professor. That's how we know these things are more likely to happen. You can also look to what my partner said, that if at the point where the gun isn't locked up, there's no way you can solve for this. All of our arguments he mentioned still stand. At that point, it is more likely that there will be a school shooting. It is more likely that people will die if you pass the plan. Thank you.
I'd like to recognize the Leader of Opposition for a rebuttal speech to not exceed 2 minutes.
Okay, so here's what we're gonna do. We're just gonna kind of go through everything that's been done in the round and talk about why the negative is winning all of them. Cool. Okay, so when we look at the two worlds we have presented in front of us today, there's the world of the affirmative and the world of the negative. And the world of the affirmative would have you believe that keeping a gun in the classroom on the teacher's person will keep the classroom more safe and prevent these school shootings. However, you can see from the negative's specific warranted arguments that that is not true, and that the gun being on the teacher's person means that it's more likely to be used in a school shooting than it is to actually prevent one. So let's look at these arguments that have been made by my partner. He talks about how, like, they say that the government's just going to raise taxes, this will avoid programs being cut. But Brendan even says specifically in his speech that these programs are still going to be cut, that programs will be cut in interest of funding these, whether he says that they're military programs or whatever. We can see that from my partner's arguments about the current presidency wanting to actually cut back education spending means that those cuts are actually probably going to go to education. So that means that these programs are going to be cut, and more people are going to be in poverty, and we're going to see school shootings increase. But let's talk more about this safety disadvantage, because this is the most important thing in the round here, is this idea, this is what the whole case rests on, is this idea that they can prevent more shootings. However, we can see that if students are able to gang up and overpower a teacher in order to obtain the firearm and use it, then that means that they can cause more school shootings. More school shootings will happen because of the ability for students to get their hands on these weapons. And if they again try to come up and say that there's some sort of safety mechanism in place so that they can't obtain these weapons from a teacher, that the teacher couldn't just immediately, they weren't readily available to be used, then that means there's no way that their plan actually solves anything because there's no actual protection being provided by the firearm itself. So for these reasons, you're voting negative.
I'd like to recognize the Prime Minister. Rebuttal speech should not exceed 3 minutes.
All right, so let's talk about the economics of this all. Now, they completely did not address how we're going to be receiving this money from the reduced cost of security. If you walk around MJC, what you're going to see is you're going to see security cameras. You're going to be seeing security guards. You see security patrol cars. All of that is no longer going to be necessary post-plan because of these guns checking back for the safety of their students. At that point, this is how we're getting our money. They completely conceded this fact. They did not address that argument. So we're completely good for economy. Now, they also mentioned that keeping people in schools is key to check them back for poverty. Well, I don't want to go to a school where I'm going to get shot by a school shooter. And at that point, the only way to check back is to pass this plan. Now, let's talk about the argumentation on our advantage. They're saying that people are going to gang up on the teacher, etc., and that it's not going to actually check back for these school shootings. But they did not address our argumentation of what is known as deterrence. Now, people may be insane, but they're not stupid. They know that if there's a gun there, they're going to be less likely to go and try to commit a school shooting. It's called a deterrence. If you know that there's somebody in there with a gun, and if you go in there and try to shoot, you're going to get shot back at, you're not going to go to that school and try to shoot it up. It's simple logic. That's how it works. People aren't necessarily that dumb. Now, furthermore, so students aren't going to be ganging up. They will be ganging up against the aggressor. Keep in mind that we're talking about if a person goes into a school and starts trying to shoot them up. Do you really think they're going to be trying to attack the teacher when there's a student or somebody trying to shoot you? You're going to be trying to help your teacher, not trying to take the gun away from the teacher so you can then do whatever you want. It just doesn't make sense. Now, furthermore, they also don't mention, well, they do, but they get this wrong. They're saying that Donald Trump wants to increase the military. Everybody knows Donald Trump is what's known as an isolationist. He doesn't want to get involved in foreign entanglements. So no, he doesn't want to increase the military. That means that we are going to be cutting the military of the United States in order to get this funding. Furthermore, you're right, but anyways. At that point, We have a way to check that, because that's how deterrence works. People aren't going to want to go and shoot somebody when they know that they're going to get shot back at. And furthermore, nobody wants to go to a school where they're going to be getting shot. And at that point, we're actually better for this idea of solving for poverty. So either way, you're going to be voting for the affirmative in order to stop these school shootings and to save the lives of these students. Thank you very much.
Let's go ahead and give a big round of applause for all of these students. The instructor likes to win far off topics at you and throw you the chance to put them together, so bravo for y'all. But one of the fun things about debates is there are winners and losers, and right now you are going to decide that. So we're going to go ahead and use a little applause meter. I'll go ahead and point to a side. You all hoot and holler and tell me who you thought went. So if at the end of the round today you feel that the government team has convinced you that we should enact this resolution, let's hear it now. Okay, and if you weren't convinced, we think that we should not do this. Let's go. I often try to pretend that it's a tie, but I think we're right. Good night. Thank you all for coming out. That's it.